Good day to you all. My name is Tariq Jappi, and I will be your presenter for this paper. I will be presenting a model for protecting personal information using blockchain. The authors of this paper are myself, Tariq Jappi, Vasi van Solms, Jaco du Toit, and Dustin van der Haar. We are affiliated with the University of Johannesburg and based in South Africa. Moving on to the motivation and problem area. Owners lose ownership and control of their personal data in cyberspace. The loss of ownership over personal data is becoming untenable, and several approaches are being investigated to reverse the loss of ownership. Why this may sound a bit confusing to most and maybe unsettling to some, allow me to explain the severity of the problem at hand. In the following slides, I will be taking you all on a journey that will help us understand the reality of our statement or problem area. Only then can we relate the work created and what we have accomplished to the severity of the problem. For some background, let us cover our basis and understand the root cause of our issue. Users have lost control over their personal information within cyberspace. How has this occurred? While users fill in personal information in various sites or are required to fill in information for companies that also include personal information, which may seem harmless at first, but users tend to do this time and time again, which then leads to users' data being spread across multiple databases within cyberspace. That surely is hard to keep track of, let alone know what's happening to the user information after they have submitted it. Users may know very little on the whereabouts of the information or possess the control to manage or delete their data. An example I like to use are these SMSs we get on our phones. Some are about claiming money from our ancestors and other cons, and some are information which are just brought to us by marketing. Irrespectively, it is still quite bothersome and very worrying. We have no way of tracking how these people on the other end got hold of our information. Common causes for personal information being scattered through the cyberspace are from cyber attacks. Billions of records of personal information can be found across many company databases within cyberspace, and these records are constantly under attack. Hackers infiltrate the organization in many forms, such as phishing, brute force, keylogging, etc. These attacks lead to data breaches, which have affected millions of people who utilize cyberspace and even some who have not. Major companies that hold on to personal information become the targets for attack and the source from which user personal information is breached. Companies like Facebook, Yahoo, eBay, and Equifax are examples of companies with millions of records of personal information and have also had security breaches whereby personal information was breached. Personal information in the wrong hands can be catastrophic. Stolen personal information can be used in criminal activities that can impact the lives of all those affected. Criminals can use stolen information to commit fraud, schemes, identity theft, take out mortgages, and so much more, which could even result in the person being blacklisted and bankrupted, just to name a few. The implications of these threats are serious and cannot be overlooked. We would need a system that would allow a user to have control over their personal information. A system that is fair, unchanging, secure, and not held in a central point. Blockchain, along with smart contracts, offer these requirements and can be discussed. The main objective is to develop a model that allows users to have control over the storage, sharing, and access to their personal data in cyberspace. What that means is that the model describes how a user has full control over their own personal information. The model further demonstrates that information requester can request access to personal information. Without losing control over their personal information, the user provides access to an information requester through the blockchain. The user stays in control of their personal information with access control through smart contracts. As mentioned in the previous slide, we will cover the blockchain and smart contract technologies. We won't go into too much technical detail, but stick to the overview of what will allow the viewers to better understand the technology and the capabilities. The blockchain is a shared digital ledger, which is transparent, immutable, which is unchanging or unalterable, and distributed and decentralized network group that allows for the transfer of digital goods such as money, information, intellectual property, and so forth. Blockchain runs on a peer-to-peer network of consensus, which allows users to transact and exchange information through the use of blocks. When a transaction is requested, it is broadcasted through a peer-to-peer network consisting of computers as nodes. The network of consensus validates the transactions for it to be verified. The transaction can be, for example, a cryptocurrency, personal information, and so forth. Once a transaction is verified, it is added to a block, and the block is then added to a chain of blocks, which forms the blockchain. The blockchain in this state is unalterable or immutable. Moving on to smart contracts. Smart contracts are program conditional statements which run on the blockchain technology and constitute a set of rules agreed upon between parties involved. Smart contracts are a concept that can easily be understood and revolutionized in the way transactions and information are currently being processed. Smart contracts are like regular contracts, but built in with additional regular contracts, they are things like automation and self-executable programs that are independent of third-party intermediaries. Like any contract, rules, regulations, terms, and agreements are predefined between two or more parties before the contracts are put into an authentic document. Instead of a paper document, the contracts are now in digitized programming code, filled with many conditional statements and functioned executions. Smart contracts help users exchange anything like intellectual property, shares, money, property, or personal information. In this slide, we will be discussing the methodology and research approach. I have added a figure diagram, which I will explain in detail on a high-level approach. The research methodology implemented in this model follows a design science approach. I do not strictly follow a design science approach, as there are many design science approaches. However, I follow the notion that design science research involves the creation of an artifact and design theory to improve the current state of practice and research. So there is some overlap with design science in that my main deliverable is an implemented artifact. Let us turn our focus to figure one, which displays the overview of what is expected from our model. I'd like to just note that as you progress through the steps in this figure, I will be describing details which may not be displayed in this figure, but is covered in the document, a model for protecting personal information using blockchain. There are a few things I'd like you to all be aware of which are not in the scope of this model. The figure assumes that the users already have repositories set up. These repositories can be in the form of a cloud space, a database, or pods, which are just easily maintainable repositories that hold single data and can deliver information to pipelines quickly and reliably and through to end users. Secondly, we are assuming that both the owner and buyer are making use of my model, the source chain, and already have it set up. Thirdly, we are assuming that the owner and buyer make use of many programs available for sharing an encryption key. So the owner is the person we are going to be requesting information from, which is the blue figure in our figure one, and the buyer is the information requester, which is the orange figure in our figure one. Let's focus on the figure. In step one, we see an icon of a deal occurring between two parties. Like with many contracts, negotiations are put into place to satisfy both parties involved. This is a sample contract whereby a party is requesting personal information. We will call this party the buyer. And the other party from which we are collecting the data, we will call the owner. These can be verbal or electronic agreements. What are they agreeing upon? Well, that's the sharing of personal information. The owner agrees that a buyer can access some sort of personal information from the owner. And as part of negotiations, the owner and buyer agree to an encryption key, which will be used when sending encrypted information over the blockchain. An example of encrypted information could be the owner's name or identity number. In case you're wondering, the rules and conditions can include how much of personal information is being shared and how often it can be used or how long it will be used for. So you can program expiry dates and et cetera. Other methods which can be put in future use can be the cost of using personal information, which can also involve a bit of cryptocurrency. Moving on to step two, we see a user icon which allows the owner, which has access to a computer and a repository which holds their personal information and the contract that is agreed upon. Well, smart contracts are programmatically coded. However, that does not limit it to only being coded by the owner. We will assume that the owner has a skill set and is capable of doing this. The buyer is then welcome to review the smart contract as well. This is a very important step, and it solidifies the contract agreed upon and cannot be changed. There will be no third-party interference or manipulations to the terms agreed upon. The owner of personal information deploys the smart contract to the blockchain. Once published, the smart contract is hosted on the blockchain, and an address of the smart contract is created and shared with the owner. The owner will then share this address with the buyer, which he can then use to retrieve personal information. From this point on, the owner is no longer required for any additional work or involvement with the smart contract, unless specifically programmed into by the smart contract. That is because the smart contract will now be automated from here on. In our third and final step, we see the buyer indicated as a normal user in figure one with access to a computer, which is all that's required. From there, the buyer can obtain the encrypted key, which is agreed upon in step one, and you will also obtain the smart contract address, which is shared by the owner in step two. The buyer can now access the smart contract on the blockchain, provided his account has the correct access granted. The buyer can then request some of the owner's personal information from the blockchain. The blockchain receives the specified personal information from the owner's database or repository, encrypts the personal information, and makes it accessible to the buyer. I've included the encryption step to serve a few purposes. Some of that would be to obscure sensitive information. As you know, the blockchain is transparent, and we want to hold the transparency of the blockchain, as well as allow user visibility and auditing of the blockchain. And how we do this here is by encrypting information and sending it over the blockchain, and that way we can still achieve the goal that we are setting out. Thirdly, we can also secure our transactions and improve the privacy. This prototype will allow an outside party to only access owner's data if an agreed smart contract specifying the requested data has been created and is stored on the blockchain. The major outcomes of this prototype is that the prototype has been implemented. The prototype proved that the Swift Chain model provides a sound basis for protection and control of personal information. It further demonstrated that through the use of blockchain and smart contracts, the user can track, audit, and own their personal information by third parties. The YouTube links I provided will take a walkthrough of the prototype implementation. The videos are numbered sequentially. In the videos, I discuss some of the technologies in further detail and a bit more detail on what happens behind the scenes. Please take note that the videos tend to be technical and thus would require a basic understanding of programming in certain parts. By the end of the YouTube videos, I demonstrate the exchange of personal information from owner to buyer and the outputted results that is required. In conclusion to our work, we have seen using the blockchain and smart contracts, we have shown that our technology allows users to own and control their personal information, as well as provide a platform to share information securely within cyberspace. The results prove that we can use the blockchain technology to facilitate the transaction of personal information from user databases to an encrypted format and allow smart contracts the functionality to manage the user's access to personal information in an automated fashion. We leverage off the blockchain security protocols to ensure that no third-party interference has occurred within the use of personal information. The technology produces an encrypted message, which is then decrypted on the buyer's side and obtains personal information, as displayed in our videos in the previous slide. This project is an experiment, but it can be expanded and implemented as a secure way to protect and manage personal information, as well as other electronic assets. It does have the potential to become one solution to the present serious problems of the ownership of personal information. Thank you for listening. I'd like to take this opportunity to thank all for showing an interest in this model. I do hope I have given some valuable insight and understanding that can contribute to future work and knowledge as well. Thank you.